Well, friends, I'm calling in from the unceded traditional territory of Kamloops Ishwetnik. Let us continue the healing and reconciliation journey together. Cooks, Jim. And we remember those who have died and are still dying, and we pray for a de-escalation of conflict in Ukraine and associated territories. We are witnessing history in the making, and it does not presently look good. Let's do what we can in our own individual communities, those places we call home, the Thompson Rivers Valley and the associated territories, Merritt and other places, Salmon Arm, where we live and reside. Good to be with you tonight and good to welcome Dave Whiting for installment number 4. Can you believe it? Installment number 4 of Your Picture, My Edit. I'm handing over to Dave, and Dave, you can share your screen. Thank you for your leadership in this project.
Okay.
I see your screen.
What do you see now, Ken?
I see your photo, my edit, but not full screen. I now see it full screen. It's a very nice blue. What blue do you call that?
I don't know. I just...
You just picked it. Okay. We have more tones available in Windows, just saying.
Ken, let's not even go there. It wouldn't be a fair fight, okay? and let's instead get into your photo, my edit 4.0. Welcome everybody. I think we're gonna have a fun evening. We've got some creative people who have done some creative things with challenging images. And those 4 participants are Al Fedoric, Don Garish, Len Lazzarato, and Michael Shafka. And they each contributed an image, and then the other 3 each post-processed it. So we have a total of 16 images that we're going to be looking at tonight. Done by these 4 gentlemen, their own, and what they think of the other 3s. So we start out, here's our 4 photographers, and Al Fedoric uses a 4/3 sensor size camera, a smaller image with a four by three aspect ratio. And for the first time in the history of Your Photo, My Edit, we have a JPEG shooter here. So what came out of Al's camera was a JPEG. And then he then did further processing on his camera's JPEG on his computer. And that's the same JPEG that was used by the 3 other participants to edit. So, and that happens to be the first image that's up today. So we're going to, the first photo is photo 1, which is Al's. And then the first editor will be Don. And then we'll have Len and then Michael. And then at the end of photo 1, we'll have Al showing what he did with his original image from his camera, how he post-processed it. And then we'll look at the whole all 4 images together to see how they compare and what it looks like. Keep in mind, folks, that this whole exercise is all about learning. Every raw image, when it appears in our computer, has opportunities and challenges. And we as photographers try to bring a sense of creativity to that, and to varying degrees, we bring various technical tools and skills. So this is an idea, this is a program that can inspire us around the creative side of things, both in taking the image and processing this image. And it can also reveal to us some of the technical tools we may not have known about in post-processing. What this program isn't about is critiquing each other's stuff. No, we're here to learn. So let's start by looking at, this is Al's raw image that he took with his Panasonic. And this is the JPEG, I say raw image, but sorry, this is a JPEG that came out of his camera when he finished skiing that day. And let's look now at what Don Garish did with this initial image from Al. So Don, what did you see as the challenges and opportunities with that, with this raw image here? And
let me first say that doing this, it sort of felt like I was invading people's personal space, and it was quite interesting. For this image, though, I have been at this location hundreds of times, and up on the ski hills, and I could just imagine in my mind what was going on. The group of skiers were thinking about where they're going to go, what run they're going to ski, or maybe they're just going to go in for lunch or coffee. So what I didn't do a heck of a lot with this. What I did is I changed the, let me just see what my notes are here. I cropped it a little bit to get rid of the tower on the left side, because I want it to sort of bring the idea of this to the skiers. And so I chopped out that tower and sort of moved in on the skiers. I did an auto adjust in Lightroom just to see what would happen. And then I did a bit of saturation to make the skiers' jackets pop. And the other things that I did was I added clarity and texture, and I did a linear gradient up on the snow, because the nice little corduroy, I wanted it to sort of pop, because for a lot of skiers, that's what they like to see. And it's fun skiing down that. And the chairlift is just basically a supporting factor to those skiers. And so I was just trying to think about what they were thinking about and simplifying it with a bit of stronger color, and trying to think of what they were talking about.
Don, I'm really impressed at what you did with the snow there, and you did a linear gradient.
And I added clarity and texture to it to make those ridges pop.
Right, yeah. Okay.
Because that's what we all like to see on the ski hill.
Right. And you're quite right, Don, in that when you get other people's images, there is a bit of an uncomfortable feeling, isn't there? That you're into somebody's kind of private space away.
Yeah, it was a bit weird, and doing it on all of the images. And so I just had to sort of block that out and just think about, okay, what do I see going on here? And what is this making me feel? So I just thought back on my own personal experiences and drew those out of this image.
Great. Well, thank you, Don. That's great. Great start. So let's move on. Here again is Al's image. And Len, you are the next editor here. What did you see as the challenges and opportunities here? And, you know, did you change the composition? And again, what kind of software tools did you use?
Well, I have to admit that there's a little game that my wife and I play often when we're driving, that we'll see an event or some people, and we like to put some dialogue and text to what we think is happening in the other cars. I don't imagine anybody else does that, but anyway, I make that admission. So I actually found quite a bit of fun and a little bit of relaxation in looking at other people's images, because when I looked at this one, then I saw lots of opportunities. I'm not a skier, and I didn't know what was happening exactly. But when I looked at it, my immediate response is there's two people that have fallen out of a chair, and there's one person down. And how do I explain that? And so I was concerned that maybe there were some events that led up to this, and maybe what I wasn't so concerned. I didn't think I needed permission to alter the composition a little bit. So I looked at that and said, the only way that this is happening is that there has to be some kind of earthquake or some kind of activity that's gone on that's shaken that line. And I moved that around. So that's where I started. And I thought, okay, I'm going to try to take this image and make it appear in the moments before those people ended up on the ground there.
Okay, so let me toggle to your image then, Len.
So you see, I took a lot of leniency here. So this is the motion of something disturbing those lines, and then I saw these folks below, and I thought, why wouldn't that happen on an evening with a full moon? And there was a space in the middle. In which there was a bit of black, and I thought it was just begging for a full moon. So I had a full moon that I'd taken a while back, and so the work that's done on this one is done principally in a Photoshop, and it's in one of the distort. It is a filter that's available, and what you can do is you can twirl the image, and you can create this distortion over a center axis, and you can change the amount. But the challenge that it presented was that it also twisted up the skiers. And so they weren't recognizable, and I thought they were an important part of the whole story. So what I did was I took and clipped out the skiers from Al's original image, and then put them on a layer back in their original location. They were the right size, and then I moved that full moon into the back, and I thought it was a lot of fun. And I don't mean to be disrespectful of Al's image. I just thought I could have some fun with that. So right. That's it.
So Len, were you on drugs when you did this?
Well, I had to discuss that to begin with about, it's just a game. I said, I got to put a story to this. I didn't understand it. And I thought, okay. We have a painting of earthquake. It was a painting that was done by an indigenous painter from North. And this earthquake, it had all these figures moving, and so that was what was one of the things that stimulated me to twist it up a bit. So.
Well, Len, that's terrific. I mean, it's. Yeah, I really like the spirit that you took this in. That's great.
Okay, well, yeah. There should be some apologies maybe made to Al on that one. So,
okay, well, let's move on. The next editor is Michael Shapka. And Michael, what did you see as challenges and opportunities here? And how did you deal with it?
Thanks very much for allowing me to be part of this. The start of this particular exercise coincided almost exactly with my decision to make a deep plunge into Photoshop elements. I've never done much in the way of processing. I've kind of pointed my camera at something, pushed the shutter, and whatever came out of the image came out of the image. So this is a huge education experience, and I really enjoyed taking Al's raw image. So when I looked at it, I thought what are some of the interesting visual elements, and what's what are some of the stories behind this? And I didn't take the same amount of psychedelic drugs in my youth as Len did, so I took a slightly different approach to things, and decided I wanted to radically crop this, because I did think the story was that little group of three people, and I wanted to crop it. I also wanted to see if I could tease out a little bit of the forest behind, because I thought the forest was kind of interesting. So in Photoshop Elements, and I'm only just, it's only been a month or so since I've, 6 weeks since I've started working on this. So I'm really only just beginning to dabble with it. But working on the exposure, the lighting, balance of it, and sharpening it up a little bit, and trying to draw out a bit more that's kind of hidden in the shadows at the back of the photograph. So I really enjoyed this, and there we are. I like seeing a little bit more of the trees in the background, and there's a bit more of a focus on the folks down below, and the leaves on the trees are a little bit more vibrant, and so I appreciated the chance to play around with Al's original image and to draw out a few things that struck me as being interesting.
Yeah, great. And great. I didn't realize you use Photoshop Elements, and it's really nice to have you, someone new to post-processing and using Photoshop Elements, mm-hmm. taking part in this, Michael. This is great.
Well, this may be old news to almost everyone else, but what I really like about Photoshop Elements is you can go backwards. So, because I do tend, maybe a lot of amateurs, to be a bit heavy on the gas pedal when it comes to making changes to things. Like I sort of super sharpen things, and sometimes I like that effect, but I'm really appreciative of the ability to be able to go backwards and forwards and just sort of see how things look. And really, for me, it's a feeling as opposed to a technical process. And I couldn't tell you, I'm still trying to figure out histograms and all that sort of stuff. So I couldn't tell [S2] Right. [S1] You the technical side of things, but I can tell you that I like playing around with the various adjustments and filters, and going back and forth and seeing what kind of what pops out when you do different things.
Yeah, great. Just great. Yeah, it sounds like you're learning and having fun.
Absolutely.
Okay, we're going to move on to the original photographer himself, Al. This was your JPEG coming out of your camera, and it's not quite the same as the JPEG that you ended up with. So what was your approach here, Al?
Well, it basically... from newspaper training, the way I started in the industry, it's you got to shoot it at about 10% loose so you can crop it later. And from there, you don't have a lot of room to dodge it and burn it and play around with it, because that's newspaper and you can't touch that stuff. So basically, I do as little as I can get away with in Photoshop and get it off my desk and out of the door to the client. So it's basically a slight crop on the tower, a slight crop on the left-hand side to get rid of this distraction down below, instead of taking it out in current anterior, which you can just leave it there. I might tighten it up a little bit by taking a little off the top and a little off the bottom. You can dodge and burn in Photoshop, and I would lighten up the tree slightly. And basically that's it, it's good to go. What I liked is with Dawn's playing with the snow, that would kind of really improved it. Yeah. And he did that blur and increased it. So the detail in that snow.
That Don Garris did.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was really effective. Yeah. Interesting.
Al, I'm curious, what run is that? Hi.
Kitty. Oh. Is he gone?
Al, are you still there?
What?
It sounds like we've lost Al.
Well, I'm still here. What do you want me to do?
Oh, we're just wondering what someone asked, what's the run at Sun Peaks? Where you?
That's
where
just underneath the Sundance chair.
Okay. Okay, so here's the four images, folks. We've got Don's in the top left, Len's top right, Michael's bottom left, and Al's the photographer himself in the bottom right. Yeah, really, you know, the two, Don and Al's crop is quite similar, really. Yeah. Okay. Interesting.
Yeah, that's
four
good.
Very different approaches.
Yeah.
Okay. That's it for photo one. And now we'll look at Don's image, another snow sheen, and now we're back to a full frame camera shooting raw. And this is what came out of Don's camera. And the first person to process this image is Al. So Al, what did you see as the challenges and opportunities with this image that that influenced how you post-processed it?
Basically, it's a little bit, you could pull some detail in the shadows and the blacks on the skier, a little bit on the color balance, and take some sky off above the trees.
Right.
That's all I would have done to it.
Okay, so that's what you did there.
It's easy enough to go into those shadows and use a dodge tool and just lighten it up a little bit till you get what you want, and so that's where you go.
Okay.
Right, right. And you've brought out the color there in the jacket and stuff.
That's without messing with the color scales or illumination or anything. It's just with a dodge tool.
Wow. Interesting.
Hey, I got out there on a lucky day of skiing. You're lucky to take any pictures on a day like that. You ski.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, well, thanks, Al. Let's move on then to the next person that processed this raw image of Don's was Len. So, Len, what was your take on this?
Well, I found this really very interesting, and it sort of reminded me of some Alex Colville's paintings, in that you had this skier with their back to you doing something ominous. I didn't know what they were doing. I could see that there were opportunities in the snow to begin with, but I was thinking, well, maybe this person might be going on a last journey, skiing out, and my initial reaction was to maybe put a sunset in there, and so that was my first attempt, and I hadn't done anything with Photoshop in the past with replacing skies, but I was just astounded how quickly I could pull that out and then put in a sunset, and then I noticed that the person skiing had a red band that was in the associated with the support on that pack and the back, and that just happened to be the same color as the sunset, and so you've got the sunset, and it sort of drew you into the skier, but I need to warn people a little bit about how we move to the next step, though, and that was that I guess for a long time I've had a lot of challenges with my Nikon D7000 and always had soft images, and I was always trying to come up with ways to improve images. And in the last 6 months, I've been interested in a lot of the watercolor effects. And so I just looked at this one and I thought, well, in recognition of Alex Colville and his paintings, maybe I could make this into some attractive watercolor. So I that was my approach. So my journey on this one, on the watercolor, was that there are a number of techniques out there, and I've gone through a bunch of my old digital photo magazines and looked at a number of steps that were available to take an average digital photograph and then give it some watercolor effects. And I've gone through a battery of these. And then I came upon a web, it was I Googled watercolor effects, and I don't know how much people know, but there are things called actions in Photoshop where you can set up a whole series of processes that the photo would go through, and you can create your own if you have the same set of processes that you want to go through on a number of different photos. But I saw this one that said that there was a set of watercolor brushes and watercolor and the actions. And so I downloaded that, and I decided to put that into Photoshop. And lo and behold, I put this photo into it. And to my surprise, this was like topaz, and like where you can deal with the noise or the sharpener. This set of actions, it seemed like about four steps, but it went through. I did a second one, and it ran for 7 minutes, and I worked that picture over and added. It kept track of what it was doing, and it set up. All I had to do was set the boundaries of where I wanted the color effects to end up on, and then it did the rest and then stopped, and then it gave you there were four or five places that you could in the end change the general appearance of the photo. But you know, I thought, well, just for this particular session, this is what that photo came out like. And I was pretty happy with that. I could have brightened up the colors a little bit, but I think it has a lot of potential, and I'll learn more with time. But again, my apologies to the original photographer, but it was a lot of fun. So that's my take on it.
That's terrific, Lynn. I've heard of these actions, but I've never heard them described before or seen an example of what you can do with them. So. Yeah. Thanks for that.
You can just download them just like any other program. You double click on them, they make their way right into the Photoshop, and lo and behold, suddenly you've got a whole new set of brushes. And if you want to do several of these, just do the processes on your own, you can just go through the steps and use the brushes on a different manipulated photos, but this one just took the steps and did it on its own.
Wow, terrific.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, let's keep moving on. Here's Don's raw image again. And Michael, you're up next. What did you see in this image and as challenges and opportunities for you?
Well, it's a lovely place to begin and a nice image, but I kind of wanted to get a little bit more intimate, and rather than kind of standing back and seeing the skier, I wanted to kind of get close and maybe almost look over the skier's shoulder and see what the skier is seeing. So I started off by doing some pretty significant cropping because I thought visually it was very interesting. And the blue in the jacket and the backpack for the skier was very interesting to me as well. A nice contrast to the grays and whites of the snow and the trees and that sort of thing. So I wanted to kind of zoom in and almost pretend like you were looking over the person's shoulder and seeing what they were seeing. I did adjust a bit of the exposure and that sort of thing. And as I've already mentioned in my early days of Photoshop Elements, which is I think the junior version of Photoshop, I discovered the filters and I thought there's not enough snow in this picture. I need to
see my first two images.
And so I decided I would add a couple of a filter with some snow over top of it just to add to it. So there we go. Closer up, kind of almost looking over the shoulder. Getting a closer perspective on the trees and
this
so on.
This one didn't even really need any editing other than just changing the white balance a bit.
Yeah, and then adding the bringing out the jacket a bit, and then adding the filter for snow.
Okay. You?
Yeah, I'm happy. Yeah, I'm happy.
Could whoever is unmuted, could they mute, please? Okay. Sorry, Michael, I hope I didn't cut you off there, but we were getting some
No, I think I think it was interesting for me. The joy of post-processing is to think about different perspectives, and so I really was thinking that I was not somebody back in the distance looking and seeing the skier and the whole forest, but I was really almost up on their shoulder and looking over their shoulder. And I tried to capture that sense of being much closer and almost seeing what the skier was seeing.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. So cropping, exposure adjustment, adding the snow filter color.
Yeah.
You boosted the blue somehow.
Yeah. So one of the adjustments in Photoshop Elements, I'm sorry, I'm not as technically proficient in describing this process, is just to, of course, adjust the blue. So I brought out the blue. I really thought that was a nice element to the picture.
Right. Terrific.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, it's great. Okay, let's go to our last image, and that is Don's, and let's see how Don processed his original image. So over to you, Don.
First of all, I'm totally impressed with what people have done. That's very creative. The little bit of backstory to this image, it's early January, just after the cold spell, and things had started to warm up. It was early morning and there had been a sunrise. And knowing my camera a little bit, I knew that I can pull out some of the sunrise colors that were actually there at the time. And this is a backcountry trail for cross-country skiing. And so I did a number of things. I actually brought the exposure down a little bit generally, but then I raised up the shadows and the whites. I masked, this is in Lightroom, the latest version of Lightrooms, and then I masked the subject to bring the skier out a bit more. And then I did a selected the sky mask, and that's where I got back the morning sunrise. It's just what was on the raw file, and to give it that early morning light. And then I did a slight crop, and my goal on this image was to try to create a feel of independence and adventure. And this track just continued to go around the trees.
And you did that all in Lightroom because
all
of the
Lightroom, yeah.
Yeah, and those new masking tools are just terrific, aren't they?
Yeah.
Wow.
And to me, that was sort of the light of the time. And it was that early morning light just starting to break through the clouds.
That's really impressive what you can now do in Lightroom. You know, that's really demonstrate some of those that real capabilities in that software now. Well, thanks, Don. And where exactly is this? Is this up at Lac Lejeune?
This is one of the new backcountry trails at Stake Lake.
At Stake Lake, okay. So let's look at these four images now, side by side. We've got Al's on the left, and then Len's and Michael's and Don's. And all very different and all very good. It's terrific. Okay, well, thank you, Don. And let's move on to our next photographer, who is Len. And Len again shot this with a full frame camera using and has a raw image. And this is his raw image. Looks like some columnar basalt to me. And the first editor is Al Fedoric. So Al, what did you see as the challenges and opportunities here?
I basically just cropped it in a little bit tighter on the sides, both left and right, in about a third of the way to get it closer. Put a little bit more contrast in the shot in the climber, then went back and dodged the bottom part of the legs and the feet in there. I tried sharpening it. It seemed to be fairly soft. Like I gave it as much edge sharpening as I could without being visible with it.
Right.
There was a bit of jiggle from the hands of the photographer taking it, or whether it's just a bit of motion in there in the shutter slap, or maybe it wasn't quite tack sharp.
Okay, so let's take a look at your image. Here you go. So yes, you've cropped it to a square, eh?
There's a little more contrast in it.
Yeah.
Still got detail in the highlights. And that's about as much sharpness as I could put force into it.
Right.
Without making it obvious as to what I was doing.
Good stuff. Okay, thanks, Al. Let's move on. The next editor is Don Garish. So here again is Len's raw image. Don, what was your approach?
First of all, it was a bit of an issue for me to start with, at least I thought it was, because it came across as a corrupt file. So I looked at it and it seemed to be A-okay, so it must have been just the way it got downloaded. So from there, I looked at it and I thought, okay, how do I simplify this image? What's the subject is the climber on this rock wall, but it's sort of the precarious position this climber's in and moving their way either up or down the rocks. And so what I did is I noticed it was a bit soft too, so at least from my perspective, and I thought that might have just been my corrupt file. And so I changed it to a portrait crop. And then what I what I did to try and emphasize to get a bit more sort of sharpness in it is I then again used Lightroom and I did the subject select, and I did played around a little bit with just the subject. It identified the hiker or the climber perfectly. And so from there, I sharpened it up a bit with that subject. And then I did some dodging and burning on the columns of rocks as well to try and create a bit more of the light coming in from the left towards the right, I believe, there, just seeing the shadows on the rock from the climber. Just try to emphasize that to show an upward movement of the rocks, trying to emphasize that tallness, but then have the climber as sharp as I could get on the rocks there. And what else did I do? I dehazed a little bit to get a bit more saturation. And I did notice later on, just on the data on the file, it was like at 300 millimeters, 1/80th of a second. So I thought that might have been the reason I, at least on my computer, it was showing a bit soft.
Right. Well, here's what you did.
Yep. Good.
Yeah, the climbing hardware, all the carabiners and things there are more distinct, aren't they? And the colors of the of all the webbing and things. Yes.
Yeah, so I just really wanted to emphasize the climber on the rocks, not the rocks with the climber on it.
Right. Very good. And again, you were using that masking tool in Lightroom.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
Yeah.
It makes it really easy.
Yeah. Very good. Thanks, Don. Okay. Michael, you're up next. Here's the raw image again. What was your approach?
So first of all, a wonderful image, but I found it wonderfully busy. There were all sorts of elements to it. I kept finding my eye going to the cracks in the rocks, to the colors, to the climber. At one point I was quite fascinated by the elbow on the climber, and I was looking at that and you know, I just found there was so much going on that I really did need to want to crop it a bit in order to focus my own eye a little bit more. So the very first thing I did was I guess like others have done, I cropped, but what I wanted to do was to preserve this idea of sort of climbing. So rather than crop it I just have the person dead center, I decided it would be more interesting if the person was sort of climbing a little bit. So I cropped it so that the climber was up slightly and to the right, just sort of hopefully signaling some movement. I got very stumped with the what others have called the softness of the image once you pull it out a bit, and I wasn't quite sure what to do with that. I tried sharpening it a little bit with some of the tools in Photoshop, and it seemed to make it just it distorted it too much, so that was a bit of a challenge to me, and I don't know about the masking tools, and maybe that's one of the ways to address that issue. As I cropped it and drew out the picture, I was also interested in the color between the t-shirt the person's wearing and the color of the rocks, and thought I would try and see what I could do to make those a bit of a focal point as well. So this is my image, you know, again, trying to draw it, have the person not dead center, but slightly up and to the right to indicate sort of an upper motion on the part of the person. And as I've already confessed, I was really intrigued by that elbow. I don't know what it is about the positioning of the elbow, but I wanted to make that a fairly prominent feature as well. So There we go. I appreciated having a chance to work on this, but I was stumped at the point where I was trying to sharpen it a bit more, because I really wanted to draw in on some of the features, the face and so on of the climber. And I just wasn't able to get it as far as I wanted it to go. So it is a bit soft on that front.
Right.
Anyway, I appreciated the chance. This was a lovely image, and I've tried to unclutter it a little bit by drawing it in a bit more tightly.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Well, thank you, Michael. Mm-hmm. So let's now go to Len, who took the photo. Len, what's the backstory on this photo, and what did you see as the challenges and opportunities when you processed it?
Well, this this was taken on my D7000, so it's a crop sensor, as it was noted, I was right at the 300 millimeter on a 70 to 300 millimeter Tamron lens. And this is a set of cliffs basalt columns that's about 10 kilometers south of Lavington, on between Vernon and Lumbee. Henry and I went out on Labor Day last year. It took us a while to find it. But then when we got there, we were really surprised. There was a team of four climbers that were working there, and it astounded me that there was no rope above that of a lot of these people. So they were totally on their own to get up there. There were ropes in other areas, but it was pretty interesting. We both had monopods. There's no doubt in my mind that the photo was soft, and that was one of its challenges. And there's a big rock fall at the base of this at 300, where the closest that we could really get and get this in focus. So Henry was up off on the side, I was down in front. And some of those rocks were just tipping, they were teetering, and you're trying to get some balance there. So I knew I was going to have problems, and then inherently the D7000, it's just a challenge to get the images sharp. So we spent a good part of the day watching these people going up and down, and it was pretty amazing. The colors were astounding. I could see the potential in the yellows and also in the ropes and the in a lot of the other elements in there. So the first thing that I did with this one was run it through topaz denoise and sharpen, and I was pleased with the results. I'd been doing that with some of these other D7000 photos, and it seemed like it sharpened up that hand, and that elbow came out a lot better, and there were some other views that I'd worked on, and I was pleased with that. And then I didn't do a whole lot more other than I used the dehaze opportunities in Lightroom. I moved photos from Lightroom into Photoshop and then work with them. But with topaz and with sharpen, it seems like you're better to work with an unaltered photo, get the work done, and then I would come back, and then I altered the denoise, used the dehaze, and we did a plus 28 on vibrance and a plus 16 on saturation, just to bring the colors out. And I believe that I cropped it down to get the photo down in a little closer to the lady. So that's how I did it.
Oh yeah, that topaz denoise or topaz sharpener really did work there.
Yes. Yeah.
You can not just on the body, but also on the climbing hardware.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's the antidote for the D7000. So it did, it seems to overcome some of it. It's not, it was not without fault, but I was pleased that I was able to salvage that photo. I got several others that I've submitted in other competitions and different groups of these skiers. Wow. But I think it's a regular destination for it, and probably not a bad photo shoot. We sure had a lot of fun there, and it seemed like these long weekends, they're popular all over Western Canada. Skiers come to this. There's another one of these basalt sets of columns apparently on Coldstream Ranch. There's three sets in BC, but these are amazingly fit people doing extraordinarily dangerous stuff. So,
a great photo location.
It's not well marked, and we missed it and traveled 30 kilometers all in the country, and then eventually found it. So if anybody does want to go, the directions aren't well published, and I don't think the climbers really encourage a lot of outside visiting. So that's how they do that.
Right. Yeah. Well, let's look at the four images together. So from left to right, Al, Don, Michael, and Len. Yeah.
I actually thought that was my daughter because she does this. And this is called bouldering, when you don't have ropes above you and you're climbing if you do have ropes above you. And yeah, it's dangerous. And yeah, she and her boyfriend go all over North America, but they go to a number of places. And I can't remember exactly where this one was, but the place they often go is just south of Penticton too.
Yeah. This is the Aberdeen Columns. It's called the Aberdeen Columns.
And where are they?
It's about 10 kilometers south of Lavington. There's a sort of a back road that goes behind the old glass plant, and you can follow that down. And there's just a little obscure sign up in a tree that says you'd columns to the left, and you go about 2 or 3 kilometers after that. So maybe 12, 13 kilometers south of the highway from Vernon to Lumbee, I guess it is. So
okay, thank you. I'll ask her.
Yeah,
she'll know about them. Yeah.
Well, thanks, gentlemen. That's great, and that brings us to the end of photo 3, and we'll now go to our last photo of the evening, one prepared or taken by Michael Shapka. Again, a full frame raw image. This is what Michael took. This is out of his camera. The first editor here again is Al Fedoric. So Al, what was your approach with this one?
I got a good think back that a couple of weeks ago we did all of this. Would have been a little bit of a crop, set the black point in the shadows. White point's pretty good where it is on the birds. And I could crop a little bit off the top and a little bit more, about a third off the bottom, I would think.
Right. Well, this is what you did.
Yeah. Here's your end crop. That's pretty decent. It shows the closeness to the civilization out there. The birds are obviously quite happy. I think in my mind's eye, the color is pretty close to what it would be on that kind of a day. A little bit of sharpening on this on it, and that was, we were done.
Right. So in your workflow, Al, you set the white point and the black point, do you?
Basically, my work is geared to producing a print in the hand to put on the wall or for publication. And your black point has to have just about 5 points of detail. That's all you need. Beyond that, you're wasting ink and you don't have any detail. And if you've got space in your histogram above, between the histogram and the frame that the histogram is in, you're blowing out, wasting space in there for your white point. So you bring your white point down without making it go muddy. And that's where you set it. And you can mess around with the midtones. It's a personal setup.
Right. Basically,
in my background, if you're providing an image for a print, the printer's got to have a dot in the black area, and he's got to have a dot in the white area, or he's got no detail.
Right.
And the color is a real personal choice on the color, whether you go with a little white and a little more blue or a little more orange to brighten it up or warm it up. You kind of have to make a choice. Was it really cold that day, or was it a nice, warm, balmy day?
Right.
Excellent. I don't want to spend any more time in front of that computer screen than I have to.
Right. Okay. Okay. Well, thanks, Al. Let's move on then. And here again is Michael's original raw image in it. And Don, what was your approach to this one?
For myself, I wanted to simplify it as much as I could. And to me, it said to go to black and white. And so I did that. I cropped it down so there wasn't the shoreline behind. I wanted to have just the swans on their own, enjoying their little swim along the lake shore, and sort of emphasize them in particular and them alone. And so I did a few things like radial filter around the swans to highlight a couple of things there. And I think at the top, I did a linear gradient to darken it down a little bit on the top and then again at the bottom. So simply a black and white.
Right. And then you provided greater exposure through a radial filter on the swans, and you darkened.
Yeah, just through the center area. So I was able to brighten it up and whiten it a bit. And so it was fairly straightforward. And I de-emphasized the top and the bottom of the image.
Right, right.
And I gave the swans a bit more swimming space where they were heading to as well.
Yes.
Yeah, and a little bit of sharpening. That was it, and a tiny bit of noise reduction. So it was a fairly quick edit for me. I just sort of said, the swans. I don't care about the houses. And I just wanted to emphasize them.
Yeah, there's black and white can be really effective, can't it?
I believe we have a showcase coming up concerning black and white. Just saying.
Very topical.
Very topical.
Okay. Well, thank you, Don. That's terrific. Next up is Len. What was your approach here, Len?
Well, somehow the image that I got, and whether I somehow cropped it when I first got it, a big part of the left behind the swans was not there.
Really?
Oh, okay. So I don't. I'll take blame for that. I looked at it and there was a couple of things come to my mind, and here there's the disclosure again. I saw that there was quite a bit of space. I enjoyed the texture of the water and the buildings on the back, and the swans. I thought they deserved more attention, and I had gone and seen some black and white photo. It was a photographer doing fashion photography, and he had placed his subjects in bubbles in various locations in France, and it created quite a stir. And I thought I'd had a little bit to do with spheres in another one of those distortion filters. And so I thought I was originally imagining that I could create a sphere where I'd made all of the buildings go around the swan. Like you could take and distort it all the way around the swan and then sort of focus the attention on the swans. But as I got into it, I discovered I had some problems with that. And I decided to focus my sphere on the swans alone. But I had problems because my image was shorter on the left. So I created my sphere, but I didn't have the kind of space I needed. So I had to crop some of the image on the right, and then I flipped it over and transposed it and added it to the left around my swan. So there was quite a bit of work as a result of not having that left part, but it was a lot of fun creating the sphere. And then I thought these were the swans that were about to lay the golden egg, and therefore they ought to be golden. And so I searched all around and I to find the color codes for metallic gold. And I did that. I selected out the swans and I made them gold in there just to create some attention around them. And the shadows were a lot of fun. So my respects to. Okay.
Let me show what you did here, Len.
Yeah. Yeah. So. So that's the distortion around, and I had to add on either side to create that balance. But they seem quite content in their bubble, and isn't it appropriate in COVID times that one would have be in their bubble with their friends?
That's terrific.
Anyway,
that's gotta be a first. Gotta be.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. I wasn't on any substance in any part of this. I apologize. It was just an opportunity to let my creativity flow,
which is terrific. It's exactly the kind of thing that we encourage. Yeah. So that's great, Len. That's just
the image title is Claustrophobic Bird.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, moving along. Yeah. Now we finish up with Michael talking about his image. So take it away, Michael.
So I live about a 1 minute walk from the shoe swap, and the retreat center where I work is right on the shoe swap. And so at least twice a day, I'm on the banks of the shoe swap, often with my little dog, Phoebe. And these swans have been a constant in the last number of months. They seem to be gone now. I'm not sure if they've gone wherever they spend spring and summer or where they are, but I haven't seen them in the last, but I was just transfixed by the swans, and they have a sense of ownership that is quite something. My Labradoodle is quite large, and she would go running down to the edge of the water barking. And the swans just would honk or something like that, and then just weren't fazed at all. And I was just totally transfixed. I have hundreds of pictures of the swans that I was taking. So the camera I used for this I've done a bit of a splash lately and gotten a few new things. And it's a Nikon Z7 II, and it's the 70-300 telephoto lens, and I think this was shot somewhere close to the 300, and I was using a monopod, but I'm finding it very difficult to get good crisp images without having a tripod. I find monopod is still not quite doing it at long focal lengths, but in any event, when I first looked at this picture before cropping it, what I liked about it was the reflection in the water. I liked the swans. I wasn't that interested in seeing my neighbors on the other side of the lake. And so I decided I wanted to, first of all, radically crop it. I didn't think of the bubble, but Len has brought to the discussion tonight a number of wonderful techniques that are great. So what I did was just zoom in quite closely on the swans. And I was, this particular picture I liked because one swan's head is up and the other is down. And as I zoomed in and was correcting for the color and the exposure and so on, what I noticed was that both of the swans have actually not quite golden, but they have quite yellow necks. And I think this is because the swans spend a lot of their time sticking their head in the water and I guess eating plants or something. I'm not sure what they're doing with their heads under the water, but anyway, they're a kind of muddy yellow color, and that intrigued me a bit. In my final image, I tried to emphasize the almost pure whiteness of their wings with this kind of yellowness of their necks from, I guess, constantly dipping in the water. And I really also wanted to draw out the reflections of the heads in particular in the water. And so tried to sharpen that as much as possible. So my final image was very much all about the swans, both in real life and in reflection in the water. And I quite enjoyed playing around with this particular picture. So that's,
well,
that's,
well done, Michael. Yes.
Yeah. I, and as I say, I am, others might have interesting ideas about how to deal with shadows in water and reflections in water. I just am totally transfixed by the sort of juxtaposition of the swan and the, and really like that sort of, trying to enhance that as much as I possibly could. And I thought this picture, the original picture, captured a lot of it. And I did a little bit of sharpening and a bit of playing around with the color and exposure, but really trying just to enhance that reflection, because for me, that was part of the beauty of this picture.
Right. Thank you, Michael. Let's look at the four images. So top left, we've got Don, and top left is Al, top right is Don, bottom left is Len, and bottom right is Michael. The various things you can do with a single raw image.
Yeah.
Okay, and that, folks, brings us to the end of the images.